Hi there, this is Solitary Ronan from Solitary Ronan Films, and welcome to my favourite 25 films of the 1940s. Again, this is favourites, not necessarily what I think are the best films of the 1940s. This is an interesting decade, obviously part of the 1940s takes up World War II. And then also we've got the post-war years, the age of golden Hollywood. So there are some of those films. Not as many non-English language films in the 40s as there were in the 50s, which, as I said on that video, is just one of the great decades, certainly for non-English language films. And you could argue the 1950s was the first decade that Hollywood kind of grew up a little bit, perhaps. So again, I'm always happy to see your comments on this series, what some of your favourite films of the 40s will be. And again, the Bulgarian Troglodyte has done videos, and Steve for Films has done videos, and his videos are doing really well. So again, I would urge you to go to his channel. I think he's had like about 11,000 views for his 1960s video. So go over there and support him, and watch his video and the Bulgarian Troglodyte as well. Again, this is just a little bit of fun, distilling a whole decade down to 25 films is obviously a bit ridiculous, and on a different day the order would change, but it's a fun exercise and I hope you've enjoyed it and you'll join me for the last few episodes in this series. And spoiler alert, the next video will be the 1930s, strangely enough. So at number 25, I've went with The Wolfman, probably my second favourite of the Universal Horrors. The Wolfman's kind of interesting in the sense that, unlike kind of Dracula and Frankenstein, the scientist Frankenstein, not Frankenstein's monster, Lon Chaney's Wolfman is more of, or Lon Chaney Jr. I should say, is more of a victim, and he kind of plays it more as a victim. There's nothing celebratory about being a werewolf in this film, even though being a werewolf would be pretty cool, to be honest. He wants to die, he wants it to end. He doesn't want to live this way, he doesn't want to kill people. So it's just a kind of interesting, it's one of the more interesting ones in the Universal Monsters. Obviously one of my other favourites, the Invisible Man. There's no sort of self-pity or guilt with Invisible Man. Claude Rains is happy to be the Invisible Man and the power. He's going to take over the world, whereas you don't get that in The Wolfman. It's a very melancholy film. It's just so wonderfully atmospheric, and obviously Bela Lugosi turns up briefly as well, who obviously played Dracula. So that's The Wolfman at number 25. Number 24 is one of the great debuts, but doesn't really get talked about. This is Henri-Georges Clouseau's The Murderer Lives at 21. This is the Eureka MOC, number 57. or L'Assassin Habit au 21. This is just such a sure debut about a police officer who goes undercover at a boarding house to try and find a thief who's also killed. Again, it just still has that wonderful Clouseau misanthropy and cynicism. It has twists and turns. It has great characters. As you'd expect in a kind of boarding house, there's different characters and different relationships going on. But it's just tremendous. And again, for a debut, Clouseau handles it with ruthless efficiency, as he did with most of his films. So it still kind of has that cold edge to it, and cynicism, but it's really enjoyable and well worth checking out, and really should be in the list of great debuts. At number 23, it's just the tremendously enjoyable picture of Dorian Gray, with Herd Hadfield in the title role, but it's really George Sanders as his friend, who again, it's one of those brilliant George Sanders, cynical, kind of world-weary, I suppose kind of Oscar Wilde-esque, very dry wit that is just an absolute joy. I mean, Donna Reed's in it, Angela Lansbury's in it. It's just so good. This is a Warner Archive Blu-ray. Again, it's in black and white, but the colour, when we finally see the portrait, it's just absolutely wonderful. And Angela Lansbury is an East End singer that Dorian Gray falls for. It's a great turn. You kind of forget Angela Lansbury's not all just Murder, She Wrote. But it's really for George Sanders, because big fan of Sanders, and he's just full-blown George Sanders in this one. Number 22 might be a bit low for some people. It's Howard Hawks' His Girl Friday. This is a Criterion which gives you the bonus of the 1931 version, the front page, which of course is nowhere near the Rosalind Russell, Cary Grant film. They literally don't make films like this as far as the dialogue and the speed of the dialogue. And it is about kind of dark subject matter as well. It's about an execution, but somehow it's still hilarious. It's one of those classic 40s Hollywood films. Granted, it's 1940. Cary Grant's rarely been better. It's just an absolute joy. His Girl Friday, that's a really obvious choice. And number 21 is my favourite Jack the Ripper film, even though it's a kind of unofficial Jack the Ripper film. It's The Lodger with that man George Sanders again, but he plays a fairly straight role as the police inspector. This is Laird Krieger's film. An actor who sadly was gone way too early, actually died having plastic surgery to try and reduce his weight loss. Merle Oberon, directed by John Bram, who's a really underrated filmmaker from the 40s, Undying Monster, and Hangover Square with Laird Krieger again. But this is just so good. Brilliant finale, and Laird Krieger's just so good as Jack the Ripper, but not really Jack the Ripper, but really Jack the Ripper. Next from number 20 is 1942, I believe. A western, the Oxbow Incident. So we don't get the huge vistas of Monument Valley or anything. A lot of this is actually studio bound, but it's an atmospheric, thinly disguised film about the mentality of lynch mobs, with Henry Fonda in another one of those kind of shining moral performances. Henry Morgan, you know his face as his sidekick. Anthony Quinn, Dana Andrews, and it's about Dana Andrews, Anthony Quinn, and an older gentleman who kind of get caught by this mob, and they think they've murdered somebody, and they end up doing or having a lynch mob basically for these guys, because they're so wound up and they've got to kind of find somebody who's guilty and somebody to be punished. Directed by William Wellman, again it's only 75 minutes, it doesn't need to be any longer. You know, the scene where Dana Andrews is writing a letter to his wife and saying, you know, I didn't do this, but it looks like they're going to kill me anyway. And you know, as usual with a mob, some people take the lead, others kind of are involved, but you know, let other people do the dirty work. And some people, like Henry Fonda and Henry Morgan, kind of speak up. But it's weird because obviously you're waiting for Henry Fonda to triumph and the lynching to all be called off, but whether it does or not, you'd have to watch the film. But considering it's been around since 1942, yeah, it's a perfect example of, if you've got a really good script, really good actors, it doesn't matter if you don't have the most, you know, the biggest budget or the most amazing locations. As I said, this is mostly set in a bar, and even the bits outside are actually studio with painted backdrops. But if you haven't seen it, it's well worth spending 75 minutes of your time. At number 19, there's actually going to be two films from this set, so you'll be seeing this set a couple of times. It's from 1948. It's directed by an Italian, but it's set in Germany. And it's Roberto Rossellini's Germany Year Zero. Again, it's a short film, it's only 73 minutes. But when you consider it was made in 1948, it's pretty amazing, as we see Germany after the war, and we kind of follow the adventures of this young boy who's trying to survive in post-war Germany. It's brutally honest and bleak. You might actually be shocked at how far it goes. And it's just one of those lovely little beautiful horrible films. Yeah, I've got the other BFI Rossellini set that I need to watch as well, but the War trilogy is just phenomenal, and we'll hear more about that later. Number 18 is a film that I think is really misunderstood. It's a film that, you know, used to be probably in my top 50 films of all time, but I think the last time it didn't make my favourite 250. That's not to say it's a bad film anymore, or it's suddenly become a bad film, but I kind of had to include it. But for me, it's one of my favourite suicide films. it's not really what everybody thinks it is. And that's obviously Frank Capra's It's a Wonderful Life. Now, granted, Frank Capra has kind of fallen far from where I used to have him way back in like the 90s. I think most of his films have kind of went down a little bit in my estimation, but I mean, It's a Wonderful Life is still a fantastic suicide film. Obviously, it's more famous for being a Christmas film and somehow a happy film, but I've never really found it to be a happy film. It's about being trapped in a life you don't really want. You could argue it's about not realising that you've got it good because your mind is somewhere else where you want to be rather than where you are. The wonderful shot was probably one of the best shots in the film when James Stewart is welcoming his brother back and he thinks, oh, he'll be able to go and leave this little town. Was it Bedford Falls? If that's right, I'm quite amazed because I haven't watched it for a while. And then he realises his brother's getting married and he's leaving to go. So James Stewart's still stuck. And there's a brilliant shot of a close-up of Stewart when he realises that he's stuck and he won't get to leave the town again. And it really kind of captures that. But it's kind of glossed over and everybody thinks it's a happy film and a Christmas film. But it is quite dark. Obviously, I would have finished it. I would have ended it slightly differently. So yes, a film that has kind of not necessarily fallen out of favour with me, but it's still a wonderful film. But again, very much like quite a lot of Capra's films, perhaps the shine is off it a little bit. It's a great suicide film. Next is a complete classic, and when you talk about kind of film noir, you can always start with this one. This is The Big Sleep from 1946. Even though this premium HMV edition has the 1945 version as well. Just great dialogue, crackling chemistry between Bogart and Bacall. Again, the story might not make complete sense, even though it makes a little bit more sense than The Maltese Falcon does. Brilliant script, brilliant performances, just two stars. Bogart's very rarely been cooler, and always has a witty comeback. And it's one of Howard Hawks' best films, and it's just it's seminal. So that's The Big Sleep at number 17. At number 16 might be a couple of filmmakers that we'll hear of higher up the list. This is 1945, so at the end of World War II. And this is one of those films that it's a mystery. It's a mystery why it doesn't have a Blu-ray. I mean, all the films by these filmmakers should be on 4K. That should actually be the law, or at least on Blu-ray. And it's Pell and Pressburger's I Know Where I'm Going. This is a Criterion DVD. I don't know what Criterion are doing, or BFI, because this needs to be on Blu-ray or 4K. This is a film that kind of sums up the duality, the complicated human being that Michael Powell was. I mean, he loved the Highlands in Scotland. When he died, the music from this was played at his funeral. It's just a beautiful film about nature and water and folklore. Another wonderful Roger Livesley performance, and Wendy Hiller, and lots of other wonderful actors. Again, great script. It just makes you happy inside. And again, why it's only on DVD, I'm not quite sure. If you haven't seen it, it's a little gem. I'm not really going to the plot because it's just like a beautiful, wonderful adventure. Now, at 15, just to prove that I'm not a complete Ozu heathen, even though, yes, I've still to watch a bunch of Ozus. I will get around to it, honest. 1949's Late Spring. The favourite out of the two Ozus that I've watched. This is just quite beautiful. As regulars, Ryuichizu and Hara Setsuko play father and daughter. There is something just quite wonderful about it. It does have the greatest peeling of an apple in cinema history. So again, I'm not a complete heathen. Late Spring is wonderful. At number 14, yes, it may have been knocked off my favourite adaptations of this story by a Czech film from the 70s or 60s, I think it's 70s. But this one is still a cracker from 1946. La Belle and la Bête by Jean Cocteau. Again, proving that cinema at times can be pure magic, even if the effects aren't CGI. You know, you can see the strings, you can see how it's done, but there's just something about the magic of cinema that really doesn't matter. Yes, Jean Marais' Beast is about as frightening as Jean Marais. But again, it just casts a wonderful spell over its 90 minutes. And certainly for a long time it was my favourite adaptation of the famous story. Just some moments that are just absolutely wonderful. Number 13 is a bizarre little war film, but it's so much fun and a lot darker, or more darker than you might think. It's Went the Day Well, by Cavalcanti, based on a story by Graham Greene. And it's about a group of Brits fighting off Germans who have invaded this little country town, pretending to be British. It definitely is darker than you would expect. I mean, filthy Nazis get bayoneted to death by sweet old ladies, and clobbered to death by young girls, and it's wonderful. Leslie Banks and Mervyn Johns, and just lots of familiar faces. But it's an absolute treat. This is from 1942, and allegedly, possibly, maybe, based on a true story. Number 12, from 1947, by Jacques Tourné, who's perhaps more famous for slightly spooky films. I prefer the alternate title that has now seemed to be forgotten about. But it's Out of the Past with Robert Mitchum, Kirk Douglas and Jane Greer, or as I always preferred it, Build My Gallows High. And to me, this is one of the quintessential noirs, because the thing I love the most about noirs is the fatalism. Characters who know they're doomed, they get caught up in this situation. They know they're doomed. They know they can't get out of it. but they go ahead anyway, and I just love that about noir. And Robert Mitchum's just brilliant in this. And Tourney's use of black and white cinematography is absolutely wonderful. And this is one of those quintessential noirs, you know, along with The Big Sleep, for example. But just that, I know what's happening. I know I'm screwed, but there's nothing I'm going to do. There's nothing I can do about it. I'm just going to go along and reach its own conclusion. At number 11, another film that really ought to be on Blu-ray by now, from 1948. It's Kurosawa's Drunken Angel, another Mifune Shimura masterclass. Again, Shimura is always the older, wiser character, and Mifune's the headstrong youth, even though there wasn't that much difference of age between the two actors. This one's post-war Tokyo, so again there's some sleeper anti-occupational force stuff in it, and the fact that Tokyo is becoming a little bit more Americanized with clothing and music, and it's kind of set around this poor doctor's surgery, played by Shimura, and there's like a stagnant pool of dirty water, which pretty much symbolises occupation. It's just a wonderful film. It's just a joy to see both icons going at it. We might see them a little bit later. That's Drunken Angel. One of the Kurosawa films that doesn't really get talked about that much because it's not, you know, one of his spectacular films or anything like that. But it's just wonderful. Next is arguably Ray Milland's favourite film, Lost Weekend, directed by Billy Wilder, with Jane Wyman, believe it or not, about an alcoholic. It's a great scene with the DTs with bats. And Ray Milland is a writer who'd much rather just drink. You could argue the ending is perhaps a little bit too upbeat, but you have to remember the Hays Code existed. It'd be better if everybody died, but obviously most films would be better if everybody died. But Lost Weekend is fantastic. Next, arguably the greatest anthology film of all time. I mean, personally, I don't think there is any argument as far as with Portmanteau films, as far as the wraparound story. This is the best wraparound story because it literally never ends. The first time I saw this, it gave me a serious dose of the willies, and continues to give me the odd shiver or two. It's dead of night. We all know what episode is on the cover. Yes, the golfing story is a bit silly and daft and obviously a little bit misogynistic compared to today's standards. But 1945, some of the stuff in it still stands up. And again, that wraparound story, the architect goes to the country house and then realises he's maybe been there before, and people tell them his dreams, and of course their dreams are all a little bit disturbing. It's the best wraparound. Directed by Charles Crichton, Cavalcanti, Basil Dearden and Robert Hamer. It still stands up today all these years later, especially the one with Michael Redgrave and the little dummy. Seminal stuff. If you're a fan of anthology films, you have to see Dead of Night. And next, we're back to Rossellini. At number 8, and it's Rome Open City from 1945. It's almost shocking how dark this film goes. I mean, obviously it's 1945, but the brutality of it, you know, the priests getting shot, not that I'm against priests getting shot, but you're just not expecting it. Again, it's just so many famous moments from it. There's like torture scenes in it, and it's just no holds barred. But it's also kind of beautiful as well. Just an absolute powerhouse. And just highly recommended if you haven't seen Rome Open City. It's just phenomenal. Now, I would say probably from 25 to 8, you know, they could probably, the films could go up and down and move around. But I mean, the top 7 is kind of fairly rigid, I would say. And these ones are truly phenomenal for me. You know, there's a lot of 5-star films in these, if not all of them. So we'll start at number 7. Ernst Lubitsch's The Shop Around the Corner. Margaret Sullavan and James Stewart. Just a Lubitsch masterpiece. Frank Morgan, or The Wizard of Oz. Lots of Lubitsch regulars. A film that you absolutely adore the characters. Again, it's perhaps predictable, but it doesn't matter when, again, you've just got star power, great writing, great performances, wonderful banter. This was remade as You've Got Mail with Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan, which I've never seen. Again, a film that you want to stay with these people for a long time after the credits have rolled. It's just pure Lubitsch gold. We may hear from Lubitsch later on. Number 6, this might be a little bit low for some people. From 1948, it's those two P's again. It's Powell and Pressburger's The Red Shoes. Again, not a Bally fan, but of course the film's not really about Bally. It's about the sacrifices you're willing to make for your art. You have no idea the sacrifices I make for YouTube. I mean, there's not really too much you can say about Red Shoes. Just absolutely stunning. Again, you know, most filmmakers in Britain were playing checkers, whereas Powell and Pressburger were playing chess. Just ridiculous, basically. That's the only way you can describe what Powell and Pressburger did. They were absolutely ridiculous. And just to prove how ridiculous they actually were, at number 5 is The Life and Death of Colonel Blimp. Arguably one of the best monologues of all time, Anton Walbrook. Just, you know, Roger Livesley is fantastic, Walbrook's fantastic, Deborah Carr in 3 parts. It's fantastic. Again, the fact that we can see it now, when Churchill wanted it burned. Again, Scorsese pivotal in actually getting the proper version seen. Again, this should have a 4K as well. All Powell and Pressburger should have a 4K or Blu-ray at least. Yeah, again, another film that you can't do justice without seeing it. It's just, it's moving, it's funny, it's utterly fantastic. And as soon as it's finished, you can just watch it immediately again. At number four, it's another Kurosawa film. It's another Toshirô Mifune and Takeshi Shimura butting heads. It's the wonderful Stray Dog. This is a French Blu-ray, which doesn't have English subtitles, but it does have a wonderful booklet. And I've seen Stray Dog enough. I don't really need the English subtitles. Again, another Kurosawa film that doesn't really get talked about that much. But Stray Dog and Drunken Angel are just such a great double, a double bill, and they're just so wonderful. Even though you probably will want to take a shower after Stray Dog, because the heat of post-war Tokyo almost comes through the screen. Now at number three, again, this might be a bit low as well. Unfortunately, I'm going to repeat myself, but it's Those Incredible People again. It's Black Narcissus by Pell and Pressburger. I mean, what were they like? It's just, yeah, let's just make another masterpiece, shall we? Let's make a film about nuns in the Himalayas, but of course, let's do it in a studio. Deborah Carr again is just wonderful. Kathleen Byron as Sister Ruth is just incredible. Obviously David Farrar's knees give a wonderful performance. Again, it's, you can't imagine 1947 post-war. Yeah, we'll do Black Narcissus and the following year we'll do Red Shoes. It's just, it's mind-blowing what these people did. It's crazy. Black Narcissus, easily my favourite nun film of all time. Just one of the greatest films of all time. At number two, it's funny, I don't have a huge comedy collection, I don't think. But number two might be the greatest comedy ever made. Certainly in the 40s, it's my second favourite film from the 40s, I have to say that. It's Lubitsch again with To Be or Not To Be. Obviously for me this is pretty bittersweet. Made in 1942, and sadly Carol Lombard never actually saw it premiered. And she died tragically in a plane crash. But man, she is absolutely luminous in this. It is our finest 99 minutes. So yes, it's bittersweet because you think of what could have been if she'd lived, but just one of the great performances. Jack Benny, who I don't think many people are huge fans of him, but he just is perfect in this as an egotistical actor. Gets into a plot to pretend to be Nazis. It's just 1942, it's just so good, but Carol Lombard is just next level in it. And number one, which you can probably guess if you're familiar with my channel, a film that's in the discussion for the greatest film of all time, in my opinion, a film that's in discussion as my favourite film of all time. Granted, I've got about five or six films in that discussion. A film that for me is pretty much perfect. It's Carol Reed's The Third Man from 1949, so it just makes it into the 40s. The score, Anton Karas's Beautiful Strings. The greatest cameo of all time in Orson Welles, the greatest introduction of a character of all time by Orson Welles. Alida Valli is just luminously tragic. Joseph Cotten as the hero who doesn't know he's a hero. Trevor Howard is just absolutely brilliant. One of the great endings. Bizarrely, I haven't actually mentioned endings in this one. I've usually been mentioning endings in all these favourite 25 decade videos. How they got away with the ending, I still don't know. But it is one of the great endings. The cinematography, a film where the Dutch angles work without being really annoying all the time. Obviously the setting and war-torn Vienna, the Ferris wheel, Orson Welles' speeches. It is just, it's amazing again. I'm not sure why this has got a 4K, doesn't have a 4K, sorry. It's just, they certainly do not make films like The Third Man anymore. It is just glorious, literally a film I could watch every day of my life and never get bored with it. It's wonderful. And on that bombshell, we end the 1940s. And that's my favourite 25. So please let me know what your favourite 25, or your favourite 2, or your favourite 7, or your favourite 17. I could go on for longer. Of the 1940s are, I do enjoy reading those comments. And hopefully you'll join me again for the 1930s. So thanks very much for watching. This is Solitude Ronin from Solitude Ronin Films, saying farewell.